What was that? I'm just sitting here with this confused look on my face going. Let's go on. The Democratic National Convention, that's always a fun topic. I don't watch politics. I don't care about politics. Now, I do care about my country, though. And so I just count on my daughter, who follows these things closely, to tell me who to vote for. And I'll do it. I know she thinks like I do, so I just say, honey, who's the best out there for our Christian causes and for the betterment of our country? And she just tells me who to vote for. She's so smart. She makes a 4.0 at UCO. She's so smart. I'm so proud of her. I'm so proud of my Kelsey too. She's gonna have another baby. Can you believe she called in on my live show yesterday and told me? So you guys got to all find out at the same time I did. Welcome to the family. Well, the Democratic National Convention has dropped all references to God from their platform this year. Now, they mentioned God, a few times over the years, but this is the first year that they've taken God completely out of their entire platform. And it's a bummer, but it sure does look like they are beginning to cater to Islam. Well, those of you who are Democrats out there, stand strong. Don't cater to bullies who want to take our country over. I think we can all agree that as Americans, that we love our country and we don't want someone cramming, a faith down our throat is that wants to force us to do something. Unfortunately, Islam is also a political system. It's not just a religion. So once it's like they don't just cram their religion down your throat, they cram their Sharia law down your throat too. They want to control you. And I don't deal with that very well, I'm afraid. We Americans, we don't give up our freedoms very easy, do we? Well, I think we're kind of spoiled, is what we are. But it does make us really tough old birds, doesn't it? We are really tough to conquer because we're just so dang stubborn. We're just set in our ways and we don't like bullies pushing us around. Live and let live. We like to leave people alone and let them do their thing. Well, our government doesn't, I guess, but the people of America, we're real easygoing, pretty much, I think. We care about each other and love one another, and we just have a little administrative issues to correct in November. So we'll be doing that. Let's see. But anyway, it's really a bummer that they're taking God completely out of their platform. And I'm going to have to take this on my ear. That's an echo. I can only talk for so long without with two things going in my ear in each ear at the same time. I've got this one link to my producer, and then I've got this link to the live feed, and I don't know what I'm. Okay. Unfortunately, wait. I have to wipe the smile off my face to tell you about this one. I'll have to tell you later. I'm sorry. I just think funny things sometimes and I get going. Okay. I saw a YouTube message from Chuck Norris and his wife. As patriots, they are reaching out to the country. I love to see people do that. I love it that Chuck and his wife are reaching out to say, hey, let's all us normal people band together and save our country. Bless Chuck Norris and his family. And I agree. I mean, I wish everybody who had the ability to do so would stand up and make their voices heard. That's why, I can't shut up here because the king gave me a voice and I'm going to use it. I'm going to say things people don't like quite often too. And what can I say? Can't please everybody, so all I care about is reaching the lost for the Lord Jesus Christ. That's it. Well, I care about, discipling the believers too. And we do. We disciple believers in 173 countries that I'm aware of. And we're bringing the lost to the Lord Jesus Christ and by his mighty spirit and praying for a great harvest. That's the whole purpose of why I'm sitting here talking to you right now, is because I asked the Lord to give me a voice so I could tell the whole world how wonderful he is and that he's coming. And he is coming. I'm so excited. I don't know when. Oh, I wish today. But, we're just going to hang in there until he does. Now, a lot of believers, think that he could come at Rosh Hashanah, the Feast of Trumpets, coming up here. What? It's about 11 days or something like that. I think it's the 16th this year. But oh my goodness. Maybe he will, maybe he won't. Well, I tend to think not, and I'll tell you why. It's because of the scripture that says he'll come at a time you think not. And if you were to take a poll of all the believers around the world, most think that he will come at the Feast of Trumpets, which is why I kind of have to rule it out. You know what I mean? But I hope so. I hope so. I really hope so. Hey, Shanna, you rock too, girlfriend. I love you. I'm so glad you're here. Thank you. You're so sweet to me. Hey, Janine, it's wonderful to see you. How you guys doing? Hey, Judy. It's great to see you guys. Welcome. If you have any questions, be sure. Oh, I love you too. If you have any questions, be sure and log in at the chat room and post them, and we'll do our best to get your question answered. Or if you have a beef with God, hey, I'm not, I am a cream puff, but I'm not so fragile that you can't tell me what you think. Okay, people tell me what they think all the time. They call me names, they insult me, I'm hard pressed to think of something I have not been called, in my stand for Jesus, and death threats all the time. And most of those are in person. But for some reason, here I stand. The spirit is good. Now, the next thing I want to talk to you about, I can't stand things like this, so I have to tell you, okay? And yes, this is not hearsay, okay? This is the research of someone who I trust and that is very close to me, okay? And I want to alert you as well, because I know we have a few local viewers here in the Tulsa and surrounding area. But this may go for people all over the country for all I know, so you might want to pay attention. This is a Christian fraud alert for you, okay? I hate thieves. I can't handle a thief. But I'll tell you what I hate worse than a thief. And that is a thief who is a deceiving liar and calls themselves Christians to take advantage of Christians. Okay? I hate that. I, you know what? As far as I'm concerned, if someone screws somebody over claiming to be a Christian, well, it's a good thing I'm not in charge, is all I can say, because I would string somebody like that up. I just would. That nothing makes me more angry than for some Christian hypocrite. Well, they're not even Christians. They're pretenders, obviously. You know, sorry, I forgot to put my earring on. I've got one on and I forgot to put the other one up. I can't handle a hypocrite like that and a deceiver. So I'm going to tell you about this. There is a Christian phone company scam that's going around called Solavei, S-O-L-A-V-E-I, okay? The company is run by a man named Ryan Wersch, W-U-E-R-C-H. Now, he's being sued for fraud and is accused of stealing $1.3 billion from former scam companies he's come up with. The last one was called Motricity, and that is the company that he was running just not long ago that is blowing up in his face now. He's pushing Solavei now, this Christian phone company, to drum up even more capital because he's in trouble from the last one. So I just want you to know, as believers, if you hear about this Solavei, run. Don't even go there, because unfortunately, you know, I've been taken by Christian scammers like this before, not this particular one. But it's happened to me before, and, you know, I'm not real stupid. So they're really good at, you know, Christians want to do business with other Christians, okay? They prefer that. And that's one of the reasons why they're successful here. And also, Christians want to support other Christian businesses, and they trust other Christians, which is what makes us so dang vulnerable to these scammers. They worm their way into a church, and then they start scamming the people. And, you know, we've got one of our largest churches in Tulsa that this thing is going through. I won't mention the name of it, but anyway, just be aware, okay? Be aware and avoid that kind of thing like the plague. And when they want you to invest in something like that, sometimes maybe it's legit, but this one isn't, okay? It's very unfortunate, because I put the notice about that on my Facebook wall, and then I had oh my gosh, okay. I put the notice about that on my Facebook wall, and there were believers that started posting going, oh no, this guy's a Christian. And I'm like, oh no. Because you know that they're the ones that are fixing to find out the hard way. You know, I hate to see that happen. So I don't want anybody within the sphere of my influence to be taken in by this guy. Okay? Do your homework. And hey, don't believe me. Google it. Go find out for yourself. Okay? So, I wanted to give you a lift today in your spirit. And I have just the right scripture for that. You know, there are always really bad things going on in the world, but they don't have to intrude on our peace. You know, we can enter God's rest and we can be happy and hopeful and joyous in our hearts and in our thoughts, you know, on a daily basis. We don't have to let the world drag us down. You know, we need to know what's going on, but that doesn't mean that we have to constantly be doom and gloom and lamenting, because for us, this isn't gloom and doom. This is our hope. This is our blessed hope. It's like the greatest thing that we could ever imagine happening to us in our entire lives is about to take place. I mean, Jesus Christ has not preserved his word through all of these thousands of years and dozens of generations just for this to be a no big deal kind of thing. All right? This is the finale. This is, you know, all of the prophets and those who love God in past generations, they all wanted to see this that we're seeing. They looked forward to it, and they could, you know, when God would show them some things in the scriptures about the end times, they wanted to be here for it. They wanted to see it in their generation. Every generation has wanted to see it in theirs. And it's us! It's us that gets to experience these things. Oh, isn't that cool that we don't ever have to die? We don't have to. It doesn't mean we won't. I mean, I could, you know, blood clot could hit my brain in 5 minutes for all I know. But in this generation, we don't have to die. If we are still here when Jesus comes, then we get to participate in the rapture, and we don't ever have to die. And all of those believers who have died, you know, since Jesus left, their deaths are erased, so they're going to be standing on the planet again, alive with us, just like we're alive now, kind of like when the Lord raised Lazarus. It's so cool. But I just wanted to, I want to give you a scripture that will lift your spirit and allow the Lord for us, you know, to teach us how to think. Because, you know, if we're thinking about our blessings and happy things and things that are praiseworthy, then life is better, let me tell you. It's better to be happy, contented, satisfied, you know, enjoying life and your relationship with God and understanding, you know, you live your life a little bit differently when you know you're never going to die. And it's not, I don't mean dying in the respect of, you know, planning for a funeral or whatever, of course, you know, I don't plan for a funeral, you know, for myself or anything. My husband told me, he said, oh, I'll just, you know, throw you in a cardboard box and stick you out in the backyard. And I was like, okay, I'm fine with that. I don't have a problem with that. This scripture is in Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely. Did I just move that? Sorry. Okay. I'll start again, okay, on that word. Philippians 4:8, because I don't want to break up the scripture with my self. Okay, Philippians 4:8. Excuse me. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think on these things." Now, see, we can... My shirt is just moving, isn't it? Sorry. We can decide what kind of day we're going to have. If you wake up on the wrong side of the bed and everything just seems to be going wrong, you know what I do in those kind of situations? I just stop dead in my tracks and go, okay, I got to fix this. I got to check in with the King. And so I'll pray and I'll say, "Lord, if you're trying to teach me something here, or if I'm in some kind of rebellion against you to where I like spill my pop all over me or something, you know, just, you know how it is when you have one of those days when you can't, things just won't go right to save your life. Well, there's a reason for that." And so I check in with the King. I'll tell you what happened. I hate to tell you about my failures and my screw-ups, but I guess I will. Excuse me. I was with my husband in out by Washington, D.C., and we were staying in a camping park there because we have an RV that he travels around in. And the owner of the place, I went to go tell them we would be leaving, and they wanted to charge me more because we were leaving than if we were staying, because evidently their monthly rate and is one thing and their weekly rate is another. So if I didn't stay the whole month, they wanted to charge me more. Anyway, I didn't take that very well, I'm afraid, to my shame. And I said, "You know what? I've been in this office twice now, and both times I feel like I'm being ripped off." And then I just left, you know. I don't get into it with people. And normally, I won't even go that far. I won't even say anything like that, because if people are going to rip me off, I believe that God is allowing that for a purpose, possibly for judgment on them. I don't know, but I don't fight people. You know, I fight wicked spirits, okay? I'm a demon slayer. I fight wicked spirits, and they do what I tell them to do, because the scripture says, "Rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but that your names are written in heaven." And so I don't fight people. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers of wickedness in high places. It's in Ephesians. But I said that, and then I was headed out of town to come back home. And I went to go get gas, and I got gas on my foot. I spilled my pop all over me in my car, and I was just, I thought, oh no, 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 no. I am not heading out for a 1,000-mile trip, you know, with bad things happening to me right and left. I'm not going to set out on the road with my daughter and drive 1,000 miles. And so I just put the car in park and I said, "Okay, Lord, I'm not going anywhere until I get right with you. And I know what you're trying to tell me." So I blew through my first break, didn't I? Sorry, producer. If I hear the music, I'll go. But if I don't, I'll just teach for 2 hours. Anyway, so I'm asking God, "Okay, help me fix this, because I can't drive 1,000 miles with this curse over my head or this dark cloud or whatever it was that was causing me to just really have a tough day." And so he brought to my mind the conversation I had with that lady. He wanted me to go and tell her I was sorry, but you know, I wasn't sorry. I'm not sorry when somebody tries to rip me off and I say something, but I am sorry, okay? Because God wanted me to be sorry. Not sorry because I feel sorry, but if God wants me to be sorry, I'm going to do whatever he wants, okay? And so I was like, oh, I knew. I could tell he was speaking to my mind, my heart. I knew he wanted me to go back and tell her I was sorry. And I was like, oh, do I have to? And I really didn't want to do that. But, you know, there's nothing he can't ask of me, and I'm going to obey him, no matter how hard it is for me, because I know better. I'm not going to fight with him, because he always wins, all right? The sooner you give up and surrender and do things his way, the way better off you're going to be. I have learned that through experience. So, anyway, I tell Natalie, she's sitting in the car next to me, and I tell her that I said, I have to go back and say I'm sorry to that lady. And she looked at me and she died laughing. She said, oh no, God is going to make you go back and say you're sorry. And I'm like, ah. So anyway, I had to drive back up there. And I walked in there and she was talking to somebody. But she turned her attention toward me because I don't know if she thought I was going to throw something at her. And I just stood there and I said, I need to ask your forgiveness. Would you please forgive me for what I said to you earlier? That was completely out of line of me to do that. And I apologize. And wow. Anyway, wow. She got this really funny look on her face. And the guy that was sitting in front of her, he walked over and he said, I feel the presence of God on you. And I was like, wow. Anyway, he always knows what he's doing, okay? I don't know if it was for her benefit or if it was for this guy's benefit or whatever, but she was like, of course, yeah. And then all of a sudden she was willing to do, you know, whatever would make me happy all of a sudden. Isn't that weird? And then the guy that was sitting at her desk, he started praising the Lord. You know, it just was kind of an amazing thing. But anyway, my point here is that after I obeyed him, checked in to find out why my day was so messed up, and listened to him, he wanted me to go back. He didn't want me to get on the road and leave town. He wanted me to go back and walk in there and humble myself. And anyways, I did it, and afterwards, my day was fine afterwards. My day went great afterwards. Isn't that amazing? But if you just have to be obedient to the King. And that can be hard to do if you have done wrong, you know. And I did wrong by, I insulted her. I basically called her a thief when I said, you know, both times I've been in here, I feel like I've been ripped off. And I felt like I was nice about it. But I still called her thief, didn't I? God thought so. God felt like I called her a thief. And yeah, I'll admit to you, that's what I thought when I said that. And I'm not, and I still don't really feel like it was anything else. But he wanted me to apologize, and I did. And then he blessed me for it, and he let me have a good day. So here's what I'm trying to get to you. If you know what it's like to have a day like that. Okay, everybody does. And when you have a day like that, you can fix it. That's my point. You can fix your messed up day if you just stop dead in your tracks, check in with the king, and find out what the big deal is. What have I done, my king, that I need to fix? And he'll show you. It'll come to your mind. He'll show you. And Natalie was laughing at me, but she's learning from watching me that she's going to probably keep her mouth shut. You know, she's going to learn how to keep her mouth shut, I hope, you know. That's kind of a work in progress right now. Well, she's 14, okay? No 14-year-old can really keep their mouth shut. They just can't help themselves. It's just blah, 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 blah. So what I have done, I have given her some direction. I have given my daughter, Natalie, who's 14, I have given her an assignment. She does her schoolwork, but she's also going to be, I've handed her the ability to produce for herself a teen segment, and I'll air it on the show. And she can go to her friends and tell them, you know, if you want to give your testimony, she can interview different teens from our area here. And I told her, I said, I want to hear from teens who are radically saved. I want to hear from teens who are on fire for the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to see passion. I want to see some passion in people for Jesus. Because you know what he did for us is so phenomenal that you just have to respect it. You have to if you know about it. And most people, you know, if they're complacent about it, they just don't know enough details of what he did for us. He's so awesome, I can hardly wait to meet him. And I want to give believers who also are fired up for Jesus and radically saved a voice like God gave me one. And I want to put them on television. And I told my daughter Natalie, I said, you know, you get out there and you interview these teens who love Jesus so much and have such great testimonies, and I'll put them on the air. And I'm, you know, when Natalie gets her segment, her teen segment together, we'll start airing that, you know, as often as she can give me the material. We'll air it for you. And I think it'll be really interesting to see how on fire for Jesus some of the teens in this generation are. They're amazing. They're amazing. I think I'm hearing a break coming along. I blew past the first one. I think I'm kind of in the process of blowing past the second one. But okay, it is a break. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest droughts and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all, here in the love of Christ I stand. His body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again, and as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ.
Okay, praise the King. We're back. Welcome back to Believer Central World Update on CBN TV. Glory to God. Welcome. I was telling you about the segment, the teen segment that I'm going to give my daughter. And she's going to interview teens through, you know, at she goes to two or three different churches and has two or three different and you're killing me. Okay. I'm sorry. My producer's making faces at me. I can't think when he's sitting there going. Anyway, my daughter is going to be interviewing teens from all over the area. So her name is Natalie Sparks, and she's going to I'm going to let her have control of her segment, and of course I'll have to review it and make sure it's okay, but I want to see what teens are thinking nowadays, don't you? I figure if she produces her own segment and I just show it to you the way she does it, then you're going to get a pretty good idea of what teens are thinking and what they know about Jesus and what kind of impact they are going to make on the world in the days to come, because they are the Joshua generation, you know? Well, I think we are too, really. you know, I don't, I know I'm old, but I don't feel old. I'm just old on the outside. I'm extremely, you know, immature on the inside in many, many ways, I'm afraid. But you know what? Hey, I'm happy and I have fun. And, you know, people that want to be a stick in the mud, they're not happy and they don't have fun. So my way is better. My way is more fun, at least. Let's go through the order of events. You want to? If you guys have... Oh, you feel old too, Janine. Wow, me too. Yeah. I cannot read some of these comments. They're so small. Let me see if I can make this page bigger. Whoa. No. Hey, guys. Oh, are you just trying to be nice? You're just trying to... You guys are just trying to be so sweet. I just love my brothers and sisters in Jesus. Oh my goodness. You will never find more wonderful people to just light up your life than my friends on Facebook. They are just such a constant source of support and encouragement to me. God bless all of you guys so much. I just appreciate you so much. Janine, bless your heart. Who are you talking about? She doesn't look 40 even. Well, Judy, she's like a real young thing. You can't be talking about me. Because I'm like old. No, I'm 51, so I know she can't be talking about me. Oh, she is. Oh, my goodness. Oh, you sweetheart. You should put your glasses on. Me too. I can't see anything hardly without my glasses anymore. You, sweetheart. Thank you so much. Oh, what a treasure. Let's go through the order of events. You want to? Does that sound fun? Or would you like to talk about something else? If you have something pressing on your mind, let's talk about it. Oh, you know, they don't seem to mind, so I guess it'll be okay. The order of the events is so cool because actually we're going to start with an event that's already passed, and that is the apostasy. We hear about that in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Let's look at that scripture. Let me grab my Bible here. Never go anywhere without it. It has really seen. It's just been through so much, my poor Bible. But you know what? It would be worse if it looked brand new, and it's as old as it is. So, you know, if your Bible looks worn, I mean, check this out. Over the years, when my children were little, they would put stickers in my Bible, and I mean, can you see? My Bible is just cram-packed with notes and everything. As a matter of fact, did you know? My Bible is the only thing I really own that my kids say that they want when I, you know, if I die. I don't own anything that's worth anything. But my Bible has got all of my notes and my thoughts and all the things that God has taught me over many years in here. And so that is really the only treasure I have to leave behind if anything happens to me. So, hey, you know, if I die, don't cry for me, because I'm going to be jumping for joy. Now, I don't want to die. Don't get me wrong. I don't want to die. I'd rather just be raptured, you know, and never have to go through that part. But if for some reason, you know, the Lord wills it, then I'll get to go home before everybody else. But like Paul said, that I would rather leave and go be with Jesus, he said, but I know you really need me here. And, you know, I know too that I'm really needed here. I have a 14-year-old daughter that needs me. And so, my husband, he can kind of manage on his own. He always does. He doesn't need me very much. But Natalie does. She needs me. And she and I are going to go all over town, and we're going to interview people who are radically saved for Jesus. So if you want to be one of them, put your testimony or a talent, whatever. You know, we're going to feature new talent from the area or from all over. If you've got a talent, if you're a comedian, a musician, have original music, remember, we cannot broadcast copyrighted music across all the borders in the world. Boy, these lights. Woo. I'm sorry. I'm sitting here breaking out in sweat. Wow. Okay. if you want to put your testimony on video, or if you have, if God's given you talents to sing or to play a musical instrument, or to, if you're a comedian, or if you got, whatever, if you got an interesting, an unusual talent or testimony, because the testimony, you don't have to have a testimony with your talent. You know, this is not just Christians. It doesn't have to be Christian music only or anything like that. It does have to be acceptable to all audiences, because we are trying to draw those who have not yet heard the gospel. You know, we don't want to just teach believers only. I'm reaching out to the lost. I'm reaching out to the community. I want to pull in people who haven't heard the gospel. And if I feature a local band on my show, then all of their family and friends and fans and, all of them will tune in to the show to see their loved one perform. And that's when what I want comes into play, because that's when I get to present them with the gospel as they are tuning in to hear their loved one do their thing and see them appear on worldwide television. So that's kind of what I'm after. But these teens also, I want to put them on television, and I want their families to watch them and their friends, and so they can all hear the gospel. And so they can also inspire other teens to stand up for Jesus Christ. And that's what I'm here trying to do too. I'm trying to light a flame under you and inside you in your heart for Jesus. Because you know what? When you put Satan on one side of the line in the sand and you put Jesus Christ on the other, there's no doubt what side of the line of the sand I'm going to stand on. And if there's no doubt for you which side of that line in the sand you're going to stand on, then stand with me. Stand for our country as a patriot. Let's not let Islam take over. Stand for Jesus Christ. And let's win the lost and bring them into the kingdom. We present the word to them, and the Spirit will have the opportunity to draw them and bring them to saving faith. And that's why we're here. That's the only reason we're here. Okay? This isn't about me. I'm nobody. Nobody cares who I am. I mean, I'm a speck of dust, vapor. My kid, she tells me, Mom, you're old and you're married, so your life is over. But she's kind of right, I mean, I'm not out here trying to, meet guys. I'm married. I'm married 21 years. So, I'm not here trying to impress people or to get them to buy anything. I want people to hear the word of God and find salvation in Jesus Christ. And that's my prayer. That's what we're all about here. And so anyway, I'm really anxious for Natalie to get on with her spot and start interviewing these teens that are radical for Jesus. And if you are radical for Jesus, put your testimony on video. I want to hear from you. And send me the link to our email at BelieversCentralWorldUpdate@yahoo.com. Send me your YouTube link. You need to put it on YouTube so I can access it and get it to the network. I'm not, you know, super computer savvy. I used to be, but, you know, I started studying the Bible instead of keeping up with the latest computer technology all those years ago. But, yeah, I mean, if you want to be on TV, I'll put you on TV. Tell them how much Jesus means to you. Because he gave me a voice to do just that, and I'll give you voice, too, with, you know, right along with me, other believers, to tell people how much you love Jesus and inspire them to seek him themselves, to check in to Jesus Christ for themselves, to pick up a Bible for themselves. You know, let's see. I'm watching to see if we're going to another break. It's the top of the hour. Okay, I guess so. Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Praise the King! We are back! Oh, what would I do without you, precious, wonderful, sweet? Oh, I just am so thankful for you guys, my friends and loved ones from Facebook in the chat room. God bless you. I'm so happy to have you here. Yeah, Sherry's in college. I miss her, don't you? Where's Where's David? I miss him today. Hi, Judy. It's good to see you. Oh, you have your bachelor's degree. Good for you. Good, good, good. I'm so proud of you guys. We were going to turn to 2 Thessalonians and look at the apostasy. I love the 2 Thessalonians. I love 1 Thessalonians too. I love the whole Bible. I mean, if I start talking about the books I the books I love, I'll just have to name them all. I have so many notes here. Okay. Let's see what we can find. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 is where we see some the events that we are about to they talk about the apostasy. Oh, I better put the lid on this. If I don't, I'll spill it all over me. I started to take a drink of it while I go on my break, and then the producer wanted to talk to me. Praise the King. Let's start reading at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1. You guys ready? Got your Bible? You guys need to be in your own Bible, okay? Don't trust anybody for what you learn from the Word of God. You can study with me here, but you need to study, you know, your Bible yourself too, and don't take anybody's word for it, including mine, okay? I try very hard to make sure that I'm accurate where the Scripture is concerned, but I'm a human and a sinner, and there is none good, no, not one, okay? So I'm just as error-prone as any other human being would be. So you need to check your Bible yourself, verify everything. And if you don't see something that's being taught in the Scriptures, ask, okay? Don't be mean to people if you see them post something that you don't understand. Ask questions until you do understand. And then if what they are teaching you still don't agree with, then post the Scripture which proves your point and totally leave your personal opinion out of it. That's how you deal with people when you see them teaching something that you don't agree with. But don't automatically just assume that someone's teaching falsely or that they're wrong just because you don't understand what they're saying. So just ask questions. You know, I'm a question asker. I'm a thinker. I've been asking questions from day one. That's why I got into Bible prophecy. I want to know the secrets hidden from the foundation of the world. Don't you? I do. I'm dying to know what the seven thunders said that God wouldn't let John write down too. I just have a mind like that. You know, if, I just want to know what to expect. And I don't know. The more I learn about what to expect, the more excited I get, because I hath not seen, ear hath not heard, mind hath not conceived the things that God has prepared for those who love him. Oh, blessings. Blessings to all of you in the chat room, and glory to the King of Kings. Let's look at 2 Thessalonians now, chapter 2, and start reading at verse 1. Now we beseech you, brethren. I can't see without my glasses. I'm sorry. I know the Scripture, so I can sit here and quote it, but I can't see it, so I better look at it. Okay. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, that the day of Christ is at hand. Now, what is the day of Christ? The day of Christ is the millennium, right? What is going on here on this? Let me get rid of that. I don't know. Computers have a mind of its own sometimes. Okay. The day of Christ is the millennium. That's the seventh day. That's the day of rest. That's when Jesus is going to be here and sitting on the throne. The day of Christ. That's the millennium. You know, I used to think that was tribulation period, but God has different names for different things because he's saying different things with them. Now, with the first scripture, it's talking about, now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him. Now, see, that's two events right there. There's a coming of the Lord. That's the second coming. So the order of these events is actually reversed here in this first scripture. The coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him. That's the rapture of the believers right there. Because see, we are attached to the vine. We don't die. And we are not a part of the harvest. See, if you're harvested, you die. See, when I know a lot of people believe that those who are taken first are the tares. Well, it's because they don't understand the concept of the first fruits coming ahead of the harvest. Because, see, the harvest of the tares, they're not going to vanish, okay? When the harvest of the tares takes place, their dead bodies are going to be here laying all over the place. They're going to have to be buried. It says that Israel will have to bury these bodies for 7 months. Their entire population will be burying bodies for 7 months. Wow. That is a lot of bodies, okay? Millions are going to fall in their desert. It's going to be awful. But it's still not the end, okay? There's some really horrendous things coming. Mankind is going to wish at certain points that it's the end. Ooh. Very scary. Now we have, so in verse 1, we have two events defined. The coming, which is the second coming at the end of the tribulation period. And then you have the gathering, which, like I said, these events are reversed in their order here, so it's not chronological for this scripture. The gathering happens before the tribulation period, actually even before the seal judgments are opened, because we are present in heaven to see those seal judgments opened. Verse 2, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, nor be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, as from us, that the day of Christ is at hand. These believers in Thessalonica were scared out of their wits. They had received some form of communication that they thought was from Paul that was saying to them that they were already in the tribulation period. They were panic stricken. And so Paul is trying to calm them down and say, don't be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter, saying that the day of Christ is at hand, that the millennium is almost here and that you're in the tribulation period. So, if anybody tells you you're in the tribulation period right now, I'm sorry, but that's not accurate. Verse 3. Let no man deceive you by any means. For that day, what day? The day it referred to in the verse just prior, the day of Christ, the millennium. So it's saying, for the millennium shall not come, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. Now there's a serious amount of information in this verse right here, because he's saying that there comes a falling away first. In the Greek, the word is apostasia, and it has dual meanings. It means both the obvious apostasy, which is a falling away from the pure faith, and it also means departure. That's the rapture of the believers right there. That's the gathering of the first fruits. Isn't that cool? And so what this scripture is saying is that three events have to come before the millennium. One is the apostasy, the falling away from the faith. Now, we have seen that happen as an actual event, as well as a gradual thing. Because in August 2010, you had four major Christian denominations fall from the pure of faith. in like a week's time. And I think the two largest fell on like the same day. It was like the Episcopalians, the Methodists, the Lutherans, and the Presbyterians. All of those. The issues were gay marriage, the clergy, single clergy being able to have sex lives. Yeah, I'm serious. I know, it seems crazy. And for homosexual clergy to be ordained. And, you know, all four fell from the pure of the faith that one week. I was astounded by it. I was watching, you know, I've been watching for 25 years now, so I've seen quite a few things happen along the road, and that was a really shocking. I remember it like it was yesterday. It happened in August of 2010, and it was that, I believe, was the apostasy as an event, but it's got another aspect, which is a gradual falling away from God by society. Once the church begins to compromise, you can't help but have a falling away among the people. So you've got the apostasy, which has already happened. Okay. Then the other part of the Greek word used there, which is the departure. That's the rapture of the children and the believers in Jesus Christ. And so we, and then the third thing that we see in this verse is the man of sin has to be revealed, the son of perdition. That's the Antichrist. And the son of perdition, this may even mean, you know, as it says, and that man of sin be revealed. That is when he's revealed by the opening of the first seal judgment. That's, he's being revealed. God's using that same word there. And then it says the son of perdition. And what that may be referring to is the tribulation midpoint when the Antichrist is assassinated, Satan is cast down, resurrects the Antichrist, and then is walking around in the Antichrist's body. You've got Satan personally walking around the Antichrist's body, just like God personally walked around in the body of Jesus Christ. And that's going to be bad news. Verse 4, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God. So see, they're touching here in the scriptures on the apostasy, the rapture, the Antichrist being revealed, the son of perdition walking around in the Antichrist's body, opposing and exalting himself above all that's called God or is worshipped. See, there's the, that's Satan walking around in a human body. And here it says, so that he, as God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. So we can see this is a mid-trib event. So it's jumped. Paul is just skimming events here. He's the first thing he mentions is the second coming. But then he's saying, then he wants to talk about the gathering to the Thessalonians. And then he says, don't worry, because a few things have to happen before the millennium can get here. So you're not in the trib. They were worried about being in the trib. And then he says, let no man deceive you in verse 3. That day, which is the day of Christ referred to in verse 2, is the millennium. The millennium cannot come unless there are four things here that happen between verse 3 and 4. And talks about, it says there'll be a falling away. Well, we know that's the apostasy and the rapture, since the Greek word has dual meanings. Okay? Don't be fooled there. Remember, the rapture is a mystery. Paul said, behold, I show you a mystery. So anyway, you've got the millennium will not come, it's saying, until you have the apostasy, the departure, which is the rapture, the Antichrist being revealed, and then the Antichrist assassinated and Satan walking around in his body. Okay, now it doesn't go into all of the details there, but it's jumping because we know that it's Satan inside the Antichrist's body who sits himself in the temple of God showing himself that he is God. Okay? Verse 5, remember ye not when I was with you, I told you these things? And now you know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. So what is it that we know withholdeth? What restrains evil? It's the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the only one who can restrain evil. And what's the Holy Spirit doing right now? His current ministry is residing within the believers. And we are the light. We are the salt. We are the preservative. We preserve the world by being in it. You know, when just, oh, we have a break coming up. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
May the love that I see in you flow from.
Glory to God. Welcome back. Oh, this is World's This is the world update on Believers Central. I said that totally wrong. I better start over. Okay. Forget you heard that. Welcome back to Believers Central World Update. How's that? Is that better? I know I'm supposed to do this a certain way, but you know, what can I say? I don't conform to things very easy. I mean to. I really do mean to. It's an old dog, new trick thing, you know? Okay, let's keep going. So now we know we have first the apostasy, which has already happened. I can't handle the echo there, sorry. We have first the apostasy. We have next the rapture. Oh, that's my favorite thing. I love to study the rapture. I think I've read everything, you know, most things people have ever thought about the rapture. Because I want to know, you know, and I scour the Bible for rapture scriptures. They're all over the place. I'm sorry, I've got this fan on. That's probably in the air, isn't it? It just gets so hot in here. I turn the fan on during the breaks to just kind of cool me off a little bit. You know, it's my age and it's a hormone thing probably too. But these lights, woo! Yeah, they get really hot and bust me out in a sweat a lot. So sorry if you see sweat beat up on me, you know. So, okay. Now, we were talking about the restrainer of evil and how that's the Holy Spirit. We are in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse, oh, my old dog glasses back on. Okay, we're in verse 6 and we're talking in chapter 2 of 2 Thessalonians and we're talking about the restrainer of evil. Now, the restrainer is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the only power that can restrain evil. We're just people and we're evil, so by our nature. So we can't restrain ourselves. The restrainer is the Holy Spirit. That's why I tell people, you know, if religious people tell you that you have to quit drinking, quit smoking, quit cursing, quit doing everything before you can come to Jesus, don't listen to them, okay? Did my stomach just growl on live television? I'm sorry. Oh, my bad. I'm so hungry. I'm going to go eat as soon as we're done here. That's so... Sorry about that. I wish I had control over that. Anyway. Okay, the Holy Spirit is the restrainer of evil, all right? And dwells inside us when we receive Jesus Christ as our Savior. And so you can't clean yourself up before you come to Jesus. It's impossible, okay? You need the Spirit to clean you up. And without the Spirit, you can't do it. So if you're waiting until you get your act together to come to Jesus Christ, you need to change your mind. Because seriously, come right now. Come as you are. Jesus wants you to come as you are. Did you know that? He knows already every sin that you have ever committed in your entire life. He knows about all the sins you still haven't even committed yet. Okay? And when he died for you on the cross and for me, he already knew every sin I would ever commit in my entire life, and I hadn't even been born. I wouldn't even be born for another 1960 something years. Okay, 1961 was when I was born, and he died. He died on the cross for me back when he was here, and when he died on that cross all those years ago, he did it for me and for you, and he knew then, being God in a human body, he knew then everything there is to know about me, and I wouldn't even, and about you and about everybody else who's ever been born and sinned and lived and died. He knows all about, he's already forgiven my sins that I haven't even committed yet on that cross. and you too. He's forgiven you of everything before you were ever born. Okay? You just have to accept that salvation for yourself, personally, because he's given you a choice. He's gone to great lengths to give you a free will and a choice. He is not going to force anyone to spend eternity with him in his wonderful kingdom and in his wonderful presence that doesn't want to. I don't blame him. You know, those that don't want to hang out with him, he didn't want to hang out with them either. You know, he wants to give, that's why he gave us a choice. So we could choose whether or not we want to know him. And he's been honest with us about how he thinks, who he is, how everything was done. And I trust him. I believe him. I trust him. And I'm going to stand as, I kind of consider myself like a knight for the kingdom. You know, I mean, I'm a girl. Yeah, I'm a girl. But, you know, I still consider myself a knight for the kingdom because we've got to stand up. We've just got to. When he returns, he's got to find some passion in us. And that's what I'm really trying hard to do, is I'm trying to ignite a passion in you for the Lord Jesus Christ, because that, if the Spirit is dwelling in you, then he's just dying for you to be willing to let him express himself through you as a vessel. And the way he restrains evil is dwelling in us. And as we turn our lives over to him each day, every day I do, I say, Lord, I give you my life to do with it whatever you will. And though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. That's what I walk through the house saying when things are kind of not going my way. I'm like, oh, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. And I try not to speak anything else when I'm in that kind of a mood, so I won't mess myself up and get myself in trouble. Though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. You know, that's what I say when I find myself frustrated or, and which isn't really real often. I mean, I walk in the Spirit most of the time, so I'm generally really upbeat and happy and everything. But of course, you know, I mean, I live in this world too, and I have my moments when things irritate me or frustrate me or whatever, and it's all in your response, okay? When you face situations and challenges and trials, you're being purposely tested to see if you will respond in fear or in faith, okay? So if things start, let's say you've made plans to go out to dinner with some friends, and you're really looking forward to it. You bought a new dress. You've really gone to a lot of trouble. And then all of a sudden, your friends can't make it, and your evening is canceled. Well, if we walk, our response is what's being tested. So you can either respond by, oh, bummer, you know, I wish, you know, hecky poo or whatever, you know, kind of complaining that things didn't work out the way you wanted them to work out, right? Well, what we don't understand is that God is in control of everything. If your dinner falls through, there's a purpose for that, okay? If it doesn't happen, perhaps you would be in the wrong place at the wrong time on the highway. Or your friends might be, you know, and an accident occur and somebody be killed. But God is intervening by canceling your evening. So anything that ever happens, thank him for it, because the scripture says all things, and that's all things, the bad and the good, all things work together for good for those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. Remind yourself of that when it seems like something bad is happening in your world. Quote the scripture. All things work together for good for those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. That's in Romans 8:28. Just speak it. Draw your sword. That's how you draw your sword, as you speak it. Draw your sword and combat that attitude. Don't let yourself get a bad attitude, because the the forces of evil feed off of your fear. That's why God says, do not fear 365 times, because it's really important that you don't fear and that you don't allow yourself to complain or get upset because of your circumstances. Ask the Lord, do what I do. This is a loophole too. I can teach you several loopholes along the way when I think of them. Ask the King to remind you when you're being tested. I do. I ask him, Lord, would you please remind me when I'm being tested so I won't be, you know, so I won't be a dork and forget and respond wrong. I tend to do, you know. Anyway. But he does. He answers my prayers, and he does. He will remind me when I'm being tested. And if I ever dare to open my mouth to complain against anything, there he is, boom, putting that thought bop, right in the front of my mind to remind me that nothing has any power over me unless it is given to them from above. Okay? That's the scripture. And so if anything is going wrong in your life, drop it at the Lord's feet too, because it's his doing. When you are saved, when you have accepted Christ as your Savior, that's how it works. He is responsible for you once you have chosen him and surrendered your life to him. He's responsible to provide for you. He's responsible to take care of you. And remember, if you complain, you're complaining against him. No matter what you're complaining about, if you complain, you're complaining against your King, because he's the one that is sending those challenges and trials and circumstances into your life to develop certain character qualities in you that he wants to see, like honesty, patience, perseverance, diligence. He wants to see and develop all these things in us, you know, the fruits of the Spirit. And we have to have challenges. We have to face challenges and trials in order to develop these character qualities. And so that's exactly the purpose for them when you have them. And if you've asked the Lord, like I did, to remind you when you're being tested, because you're always being tested, always. We're monitored 24/7. Everything we do, say, think is all written down. It's really scary if you think about it. It'll make you think twice before you open your mouth just without thinking and just, blah, 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 you know, and let all kinds of complaints and or gossip or, you know, speaking evil about someone else. He will stop you from doing that. And you'll be glad. You know, I'm really thankful for his firm hand in my life, because I want to be pleasing to him. I want to do what he wants me to do. And I really want so much to see him smile and to be happy with me. I don't want to hang my head in shame when I stand before him. And I just can't live with that. And so, anyway, I'm rambling, aren't I? Sorry. That's my bad. Okay. I'll get back to the scripture now. The mystery of iniquity doth already work. This is verse 7 of 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. So we know what is withholding, and that is the Holy Spirit in us that is restraining evil. And it says, the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. Now, the Spirit is in control of everything. Okay? Right here, he's telling us that he's restraining through us, but he's also allowing the mystery of iniquity to, through people, you know, he's also allowing them to proliferate and to do their damage. But soon the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. This is a small, h in the scripture. And so what he, okay, we'll talk about when we get back. Stay tuned. Safely to arrive at home. Jesus saw me when a stranger wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood.
Praise.
So good. Mountain Dew. I don't realize how dry my throat gets. I'm just talking so much. Sorry, I have a little fan here that's just so hot in here. I'll turn it off so I won't bug you guys on the mic. All right, welcome back. We're going to take this last 15 minutes. Goodness, the time just goes so fast. I love to hang out with you guys. Let's blaze through some of these other events real quick. So we've got, remember the order now? We've got the apostasy. Then we've got the rapture. Then the seal judgments. The first one, the Antichrist, is revealed. The second one is the wars that we see brewing over there. The third is global famine. The fourth is massive death. After that, you have, after the wars are over, Israel buries those bodies for 7 months and burns the weapons they collect from that field of dead bodies for 7 years. That 7 years ends at the tribulation midpoint. So we've got the seal judgments opened, Israel burying bodies and burning weapons. Now, Israel's going to be burning weapons for about 3.5 years prior to the start of the tribulation period. So, you know, the tribulation period is not going to start in 2013, even though the Antichrist may be here. See, the Antichrist is revealed prior to the tribulation period, and there's a lot of things that he has to accomplish before the trib actually officially starts. The tribulation period, which is Daniel's 70th week of years, officially starts with the signing of a treaty between Israel and the many. Now, we know this is not Oslo. This is not the peace process that's happening right now, because there is no peace. Okay? The scripture tells us that when this peace is signed, that it's going to produce several things. One, the whole world is going to rejoice and go, wow, peace and safety, finally. You know, the scripture tells us that. And another thing that's going to happen is that this treaty is going to facilitate Israel being able to rebuild their temple on the Temple Mount. Okay? So that's why I find all of this talk over the years about turning Jerusalem into an international city where all three of the major faiths that are originate there. Well, Islam doesn't originate there. They just don't like the Jews being in their earth. They don't want the Jews anywhere in their earth. They don't like them anywhere. So you can't please them no matter what you do. Okay, am I going too fast? Oh, okay, I get what you're saying there. So the Antichrist is revealed, the four seal judgments are opened, the Jews bury bodies, burn weapons. 3.5 years later, you have the trib starting, the world crying peace and safety, the temple will begin to be rebuilt, and the first 3.5 years of the tribulation period will not have any more seal judgment openings right during that time where the Antichrist is taking over the world government. And he's, by the time the treaty is signed and the tribulation officially starts, the Antichrist has got his world government going. He's got his new economic system. All of this is already taking place in those 3.5 years prior to the start of the tribulation period. Because once the Antichrist is brokering the peace treaty, he is proclaimed the Messiah, okay? Then the people are going to listen to him. It says that he will cause craft to prosper. He will get the world back on its feet economically with his new economic system that uses the mark implanted in your hand or forehead to access the world economy. And then without the mark, you will not have access to it. Without the mark, you will not be able to get any government benefits, any food assistance, nothing. You are on your own. But if you take that mark, you are damning your soul to hell forever. Let's look at real quickly Revelation chapter 14. Wow, I turned right to it. Thank you, my king. Revelation chapter 14, verse 9. I'll give you a second to find that. if you want to look at it. Let's see. Princessa says, did you hear that Obama has this sand statue and is planning to bring it on TV tomorrow? A sand statue. I don't know anything about that. What? Can you elaborate a little bit? What do you mean? It's going to be... He has a sand statue. I'm not sure what that means. If you can explain that to me a little bit there, Judy. A sand statue. I personally don't think Obama is the Antichrist. He's not evil enough or impressive enough in my book. But the Antichrist is just going to be a regular man until the opening of the first seal judgment and the spirit is released that will rest upon him and cause him to become the Antichrist. And he will have supernatural abilities to call fire from heaven and all kinds of crazy things. The people are going to think he's God. And that is what we're trying to combat here. We don't want them to think he's God. We want them to know exactly who he is. And in Revelation 14:9, let's start reading there. And the third angel followed them. Let me tell you first, before we go here. This is what happens to you if you take the mark of the beast. Okay? Without it, you're going to starve, be on the street, whatever. You're going to be on your own. But if you take it, here's what happens. Now, you need to know this because factor this into your decision before you take the mark of the beast. Okay? Verse 9. Of Revelation chapter 14, and the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. And they have no rest day nor night who worship the beast in his image and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So, whoa. Do not take any kind of a mark in your right hand or in your forehead. This would be some kind of an electronic thing because, you know, I don't know what kind of technology specifically, but I know that the mark of the beast is already here and active. It's been here for 14 years and people have been taking it in their hand. And being scanned, you know? So, it's be aware, because the mark of the beast is here right now, all right? People are taking it right now, and it is the mark, and they are losing their souls. The Lord Jesus Christ has warned us not to take any kind of a mark in our right hand or forehead, and we must heed what he has to say. So, at the tribulation midpoint, we've got several events that occur that change the course of the way things go, and things get way worse. The seal judgments begin to be opened. Once the tribulation is in full swing and you draw near to the trib midpoint, you've got several events. You've got the Antichrist. The Antichrist is assassinated, for one. For two, Satan is cast out of heaven. For three, Satan resurrects the Antichrist's body and is walking around in it for the remaining 3.5 years of the tribulation, which is why it is referred to as the Great Tribulation. You've got the Antichrist defiling the temple. And the Jews have to flee for their lives because the Antichrist overruns Jerusalem and Israel. And 2/3 of the precious people in Israel will die when that happens. And the other 1/3, the remnant, who God is preserving will flee, probably to Petra. It says they will flee into the mountains. And Petra is over in Jordan, and it's a very protected spot where God can protect them and provide for them. But let's see, what else? There's several events that happen right there. The seal judgments start being opened again. The temple is defiled, the Jews flee, and the mark becomes mandatory at that time, which means you will be arrested and executed if you refuse to take it when the devil's walking around in the Antichrist's body. So, I'm sorry, I'm clicking my ink pen again. My bad. I'm sorry. I don't mean to do that to you guys. Oh, I can't believe this show is almost over. I just love visiting with you guys. I could do this for hours and hours. Seriously, I could just sit here and teach for hours on end. I have so much to say. It's like I get started and then my time is up. But the trib midpoint is going to be where the believers begin to be beheaded and slaughtered by the millions. And that is the harvest of the wheat. Okay. And this is a harvest. See, the harvest of the tares, there's going to be dead bodies everywhere. Dead bodies mean, you know, harvest means dead bodies. Okay. Harvest of the tares, you've got dead bodies. Harvest of the wheat, you've got dead bodies. But these bodies are being beheaded. Okay. But with the first fruits, the rapture, there are no dead bodies. You've got just a disappearance. We just disappear. We're not dead. We're still alive. We've just been evacuated and relocated to a place of safety in the holy city while the tribulation and all these terrible events with the wars and the judgments are taking place here on the earth. God bless you guys. I'm so happy that you're here. I really miss you all when you're not here. I notice every single one of you. And what I may miss some things that are being said while I'm teaching, but I'm trying to pay attention to what's going on anyway. I know that a lot of you really love Jesus and you want to be effective for the kingdom. My advice to you would be to pray. And, you know, what I do is I just say, Lord, I give you my life. And I give you full control of everything I think, everything I say, and everything I do in Jesus' name. And if you do that, you will see that the Lord will take control of your life and it will get so much better so fast. It may initially get a little tougher because he's going to want to try you a bit and see if you're serious, because you're going to have to be determined. He's got the kind of personality where he's going to throw some obstacles at you. And if he can, you know, if you can be diverted from seeking him, then you will. He's going to see to it. He is calling to those who have their eyes so fixed on him that they can't be diverted. So don't you let yourself be diverted from pursuing the Savior and walking in the Spirit. God bless you guys. Oh, it's time to go already. Looks like 1 minute or less, but I just want to thank you for tuning in. Tell your friends and neighbors to tune in to Let's Lift the Name of Jesus Christ up high and praise him and be ready for his soon return. Hope to see you again tomorrow, should the Lord tarry, here, there, or in the air. Take care.